Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Fractals, A Very Short Introduction by Kenneth Falconer. Narrated by Jason Huggins.
Preface. To many people, the word geometry conjures up circles, cubes, cylinders, and other regular or smooth objects. Familiar artifacts such as buildings, furniture, or cars make wide use of such shapes. However, many phenomena in nature and science are anything but regular or smooth. For example, a natural landscape may include bushes, trees, rugged mountains, and clouds, which are far too intricate to be represented by classical geometric shapes. Surprisingly, apparently complex and irregular objects can often be described in remarkably simple terms. Fractal geometry provides a framework in which a simple process involving a basic operation repeated many times can give rise to a highly irregular result. Fractal constructions can represent natural objects, but also give rise to a vast array of other shapes, which may be of extraordinary complexity. The phrase, "the beauty of fractals," is often heard, a phrase which reflects the unending intricacy of fractal designs alongside the simplicity which underlies their ever-repeating form. Indeed, complex but attractive fractal pictures have become an art form in their own right, with exhibitions, competitions, and their use on designer clothing. The aim of this book is to show, in basic terms, how fractals may be constructed, described, and analyzed as geometrical objects, and how these mathematical fractals relate to the real fractals of nature and science. Geometry, particularly fractal geometry, is very much a visual subject, and diagrams and a visual intuition are key to its appreciation. Inevitably, some mathematics is required, but this is presented alongside a visual and intuitive interpretation, and hopefully will not present too great an obstacle to the dedicated listener prepared to think through the concepts involved. In a couple of places, to keep the mathematics in the main part of the chapters to a minimum, further details are deferred to an appendix that is attached as a PDF to this audiobook. Since fractals became popular in the 1980s, their theory and applications have developed beyond recognition, with fractals pervading many areas of mathematics and science, as well as economics and social science. Fractals are central to a great deal of sophisticated research, which has at its heart the simple ideas that are sketched in this very short introduction. If the reader is able to appreciate some of these ideas, then the book will have succeeded in its aim. Chapter 1. The Fractal Concept. The Rise of Fractals. Since ancient times, mathematics and science have developed alongside each other, with mathematics used to describe and often explain observed natural and physical phenomena. In many areas, this marriage has been highly successful. Indeed, much of what we enjoy in modern life is a consequence of its success. For example, the mathematical methods and laws introduced by Isaac Newton underlie the operation of almost everything mechanical, from riding a bicycle to the orbit of a spacecraft. James Clerk Maxwell's equations of electromagnetism hastened the understanding and development of radio communication. A picture on a computer screen can only be created or moved around using a mouse because a great deal of geometrical calculation has gone into designing the software. Nevertheless, there are phenomena which, although governed by the basic laws of science, were historically regarded as too irregular or complex to be described or analyzed using traditional mathematics. Classical geometry concentrated on smooth or regular objects, such as circles, ellipses, cubes, or cones. The calculus, introduced by Newton and Leibniz in the second half of the 17th century, was an ideal tool for analyzing smooth objects and rapidly became so central both in mathematics and science that any attempt to consider irregular objects was sidelined. Indeed, many natural phenomena were overlooked, perhaps deliberately, because their irregularity and complexity made them difficult to describe in a form that was mathematically manageable. It was not until the late 1960s that the study of irregular figures started to develop in a systematic way, largely as a result of efforts by the French-American polymath Benoit Mandelbrot, 1924 to 2010, often referred to as the father of fractals. In his 1982 book, The Fractal Geometry of Nature, he wrote, "Clouds are not spheres. Mountains are not cones. Coastlines are not circles, and bark is not smooth, nor does lightning travel in a straight line." He argued that highly irregular objects should be regarded as commonplace rather than as exceptional, and moreover, that many phenomena across physics, biology, finance, and mathematics have irregularities of a form that are akin to each other. Mandelbrot introduced the word fractal as a general description for a large class of irregular objects and highlighted the need for a fractal mathematics to be developed, or in some cases, retrieved from isolated forgotten papers. Since the 1980s, fractals have attracted widespread interest. Virtually every area of science has been examined from a fractal viewpoint, with fractal geometry becoming a major area of mathematics, both as a subject of interest in its own right and as a tool for a wide range of applications. Fractals have also achieved a popular vogue, with attractive, highly colored fractal pictures appearing in magazines, books, and art exhibitions, and even used for scenery in science fiction films. Further public interest has been generated with the widespread use of computers at home and at school, enabling anyone with a basic knowledge of programming to generate intricate fractal pictures by repeatedly applying a simple operation. Of course, there is always a difference between idealized mathematical objects and the real phenomena that they may represent. A circle has a precise definition, as those points on a piece of paper or other flat surface whose distance from a center exactly equals a given radius, and a sphere consists of those points in space with the same property. We may refer to a coin or wheel as circular, and an orange or the earth as spherical, but these are only approximate descriptions. On close examination, the surface of an orange is dimpled and may be slightly flattened at the top and bottom, so it is not quite a sphere, and the Earth's surface is covered with hills and valleys. Nevertheless, in the right context, it is extremely useful to regard these objects as circles or spheres. If you want to calculate the number of oranges that can be packed into a box, it is good enough to assume that they are spherical. And when computing orbits of the Earth around the Sun or the Moon around the Earth, little is lost by assuming that these bodies are indeed spheres. In the same way, we define fractals in a mathematically exact manner, but we will also encounter natural, physical, and economic phenomena that can usefully be regarded as fractals when viewed over an appropriate range of scales. These will be thought of as real, as opposed to mathematical, fractals, with the fractal description inevitably ceasing to be valid if they are examined too closely. This book contains pictures of various fractals, but they are no more than approximations to the exact mathematical objects which possess detail at a far finer scale than anything that can be printed on a page. A first fractal construction, the von Koch curve. Let's start with a shape that can be drawn, at least very roughly, using just a pencil and eraser. Take a straight line and divide it into three equal pieces. Erase the middle piece and replace this by the other two sides of an equilateral, or equal-sided, triangle on the same base. This gives a chain of four shorter, joined-up, straight-line segments. Now, do exactly the same thing with each of these four pieces. Remove the middle thirds and replace by the other two sides of the equilateral triangles on the same base, to get a chain of 16 straight pieces. and now repeat this process again and again. In principle, we carry on forever with this procedure. But before long, the figure becomes indistinguishable to the eye from the curve. This is known as the von Koch curve, introduced and studied by the Swedish mathematician Helga von Koch, 1870 to 1924, in 1906. Note that the word curve is used here simply to mean a path that can be traced from one end to the other, without any implication of smoothness. Look more closely at the von Koch curve. On zooming in on the curve, however much we magnify it, irregularities in its shape will always be apparent. Indeed, the curve contains tiny von Koch curves just as wiggly as the original. This is a direct consequence of the construction, wherein the very small line segments were treated in just the same way as the original one, but at a smaller size. An object which has such irregularity at arbitrarily small scales is said to have a fine structure. This is very different from, say, a circle, where a small portion of the perimeter sufficiently magnified will appear almost indistinguishable from a straight line. Looking from another viewpoint, the von Koch curve is self-similar. That is, it is made up of smaller scale copies of itself. In particular, we could cut it into four parts, each a one-third scale copy of the entire curve. Thinking of this another way, four photocopies of the whole von Koch curve at 33 1/3% reduction can be positioned and joined together to form a curve identical to the original. But there are also self-similarities at smaller scales. The curve is made up of 16 copies of itself at 1/9 scale, 64 copies at 1/27 scale, and so on. Everywhere on the curve, and at whatever enlargement, there are many tiny copies of the whole curve. Smooth curves, circles, ellipses, etc., have a tangent at each point. That is a straight line that neatly touches the curve. This can be thought of as the instantaneous direction of travel of a point traversing the curve. This notion of a tangent, or direction at each point, is central to the way that mathematicians have for centuries studied curves. It is the essence of the calculus. However, the von Koch curve does not have a well-defined direction or slope at any point, and one cannot draw tangents to the curve. It is far too irregular to be described in traditional geometrical language and, unlike classical shapes, cannot be expressed by a simple formula. The methods of classical mathematics are not applicable to the von Koch curve. To find the perimeter length of a circle, one might walk around the circle taking very small steps, and multiply the step length by the number of steps taken. If the circle is of radius 1, kilometers, meters, yards, the units don't matter so long as we are consistent. Then if the steps are small, the answer will be very close to 6.283, that is, 2 pi, which is the perimeter length. We might try the same approach to measure the length of the von Koch curve. Assuming that the initial line segment in the construction has length 1, then traversing the curve with a step of length 1/10 will require about 19 steps, corresponding to a length walked of 19 times 1/10 equals 1.9. If we reduce our step length to 1/100th, then our walk around the curve will visit many more of the small corners of the curve and will take about 334 steps, a length 334 times 1/100th equals 3.34. And if we take tiny steps of, say, length 1/1,000,000th, following around the irregularities of the curve will necessitate about 37.25 million steps, giving a length of 37.25. Unlike with the circle, trying to measure the von Koch curve by dividing it into shorter and shorter steps just gives even larger estimates for its length. The size depends on the scale at which the length is measured. another property that distinguishes the von Koch curve from the circle or other classical geometrical figures. In all these ways, the von Koch curve is a very intricate and complicated object. Yet in other ways, it is very simple. Its construction can be described in a short sentence. Repeatedly replace the middle third of each line segment with the other two sides of an equilateral triangle. It is a recursive construction. That is, it involves performing a simple step over and over again. If we take three copies of the von Koch curve and join them corner to corner in a triangle, then we get a rather idealized von Koch snowflake. With a bit of imagination, the curve has a natural appearance. To summarize, the von Koch curve possesses the following properties: fine structure, detail at all scales, however small; self-similarity, made up of small-scale copies of itself in some way; classical methods of geometry and mathematics are not applicable; size depends on the scale at which it is measured; a simple recursive construction; a natural appearance. A curve or other object with such properties is called a fractal, a word coined by Benoit Mandelbrot in 1975 from the Latin fractus, meaning broken. These features will be prominent in the wide range of fractals that will be encountered in the following chapters. A word of caution about this definition of a fractal. We have termed an object a fractal if it satisfies several conditions, some of which are a little vaguely framed. Is there a more precise definition of a fractal? There has been considerable debate about this ever since the term was introduced. Mandelbrot originally proposed a technical definition in terms of dimensions, but this was abandoned because there were plenty of objects that did not fit in with the definition, but which clearly ought to be considered fractals. The current consensus is to regard something as a fractal if all or most of the properties listed above, along with one or two other more technical ones, hold in some form. This is somewhat analogous to the way biologists define life. Something is held to be alive if it has all or most of the characteristics on a list: ability to grow, ability to reproduce, ability to respond to stimuli in some way, etc. Nevertheless, there are things which are obviously alive, but which don't have quite all the properties on the list. Some more examples. Fractals with a completely different appearance may be constructed by a very similar recursive procedure. We obtained the von Koch curve by repeatedly replacing each straight line segment by a simple triangular figure, sometimes called a generator or motif of the curve. Consider two examples of fractals constructed using other generators. Again, by replacing line segments by scaled down copies of the generator. The first example is the squig curve, generated by a square wave. The second is a fractal grass, with its natural appearance a consequence of the twigs of the generator being at a slight angle to the main stem. Note how the list of fractal properties applies in each case. There are endless possibilities for producing fractals in this way from different generators. Coordinates, functions, and itineraries. The fractals we have seen are drawn on a piece of paper and could equally well be displayed on a computer screen. Such a flat surface is referred to as a plane. Of central interest to us are black and white pictures drawn on a plane, that is, any collection of points on a plane regarded as an entity. We will refer to such a collection of points as an object, a shape, a figure, or, to use the mathematician's term, a set. Thus, in general, a set might refer to a circle, a von Koch curve, a collection of paint splashes on a page, or a silhouette of a person. To describe fractals, and indeed any set, we need a means of specifying positions on a plane. The standard way of doing this uses coordinates. sometimes called Cartesian coordinates after René Descartes, 1596 to 1650, who introduced them, which specify points in a similar way to longitude and latitude on a map, or the eastings and northings of a map grid reference. Choose some point of the plane, called the origin. Any point of the plane may be reached from the origin by traveling a certain distance horizontally and then turning through a right angle and traveling another distance vertically. The location of the point is given by a pair of numbers, the first being the horizontal distance traveled, and the second, the vertical distance. These numbers are the coordinates of the point. Thus, the pair of coordinates, 3, 2, gives the position of the point distance 3 along and 2 up. It is usual to draw horizontal and vertical lines through the origin, called the x-axis and y-axis respectively, which may be marked with scales to indicate the distances in each of the perpendicular directions. By convention, the positive numbers represent distances to the right, or upwards from the origin, and negative numbers denote distances to the left or downwards. We usually identify the coordinate pair with the point itself, so we refer to the point 3-2 in the plane. We also need to relate points in the plane, and one very useful way of doing this is by using functions. For our purposes, a function is simply a rule or formula which, for each point in the plane, specifies some other point. We will frequently think of a function as an instruction that tells you how to move around the plane. If you are at some point, the function tells you another location to which to move. Technically, such a function should be referred to as a function from the plane to itself. But all functions referred to in this audiobook will be of this form. We will use arrows, with the right arrow being spoken becomes, to denote functions, for example, the function point xy, right arrow, or becomes, point x plus 1, y, this is formula 1, says that if you are at the point with coordinates xy, you move to the point with coordinates x plus 1, y. The effect of this function on a specific point, 2, 5, say, is found by substituting the pair 2, 5 into the formula 1, replacing x by 2 and y by 5. So 2, 5 becomes 2 plus 1, 5 equals 3, 5. Thus, the function moves the point 2, 5 to 3, 5. Similarly, it moves the point 3, 7 to 4, 7, and negative 3, negative 7, to negative 2, negative 7. This function has the effect of adding 1 to the first coordinate of the point, and leaving the second coordinate unchanged. So geometrically, the function moves every point a distance 1 to the right. For example, the function given by point xy becomes point 1 half x, 1 half y, this is formula 2, halves both coordinates, so takes each point to the point midway between it and the origin. So, for example, 6-2 becomes 3-1, and 3-2 becomes 1.5-1. We saw with the von Koch curve that repeating a simple operation over and over again produced an intricate fractal. Similarly, applying a function repeatedly can also lead to highly complex objects. Given a function and some...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.